بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الواحد المنعم والصلاة والسلام على محمد سيد الأنام وعلى آله الكرام وصحبه العظام وسلم تسليما كثيرا ما دام يجري هذا النظام وبعد قال تبارك وتعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا اذكروا الله ذكرا كثيرا وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لأم أنس رضي الله عنها أكثري من ذكر الله تعالى فإنك لا تأتين الله بشيء أحب إليه من كثرة ذكره أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. Respected elders, brothers, mothers, sisters and youngsters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, our Creator, our Sustainer, Cherisher, Nourisher, the only entity entitled to worship. And we send the choicest blessings upon the final messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings upon him. Some time ago, I came across an article in the Toronto Star in regards to an occurrence that took place right here in the Scarborough area. So there's this owner of an exotic fish museum where exotic fish from across the world are brought and they're placed in this specific museum, both for sale as well as to be amazed by the qudra and the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now the owner of this particular exotic fish museum walked into his facility one morning only to find that 70% of the fish that he had got from all across the world, they're all dead. And he investigated the matter and he realized that there was some contamination in the water, and because of this contamination with a chemical or some bleach, it caused these exotic fish to die, to perish, to end their lives, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So just like these fish require water for their survival, the point I'm making here is for our survival, we require the remembrance and the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A supplication of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, and this is what I would like to remind myself and everyone here about today, is we need to reinforce, we need to constantly increase in the remembrance, obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we have Allah, we have everything. But if we disconnect with the Creator, then in reality we have nothing. We may believe, we may perceive, we may assume that we have, but in reality we don't. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, to demonstrate, to reinforce this point of the deep connection that we are to have with Allah, we can learn so much from the supplications of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. In one of the supplications he made, he said, Ya Allah, Allahumma la takilni ila nafsi tarfata ayn. O Allah, let it not be that you leave me to myself even to the extent of a blink of an eye. O Allah, do not leave me to my own understanding, to my own perceptions, to my own logic and intelligence, even to the extent of a wink of an eye, a blink of an eye. So that's how much we need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the importance of reinforcing and connecting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the theme here today. Sabru Ayyub is very known, very well known. It's talked about, the patience of Ayyub alayhi salatu wassalam. It comes in the books of tafsir, in Madarikut Tanzeel. The author writes that when we study the life of Ayyub alayhi salatu wassalam, he went through so much challenges. He went through so many difficulties that such a sickness he was involved in that he became paralyzed. And there was a stench from his body that people did not want to go near him. Even those people who were appointed to take care of him, they gave up. They said, we cannot tolerate this individual and the stench or the difficulty that he's going through. His family also abandoned him. And he was thrown in the region where you generally throw rubbish, garbage, or things that are of no use. And the author of Madarik al-Tanzil, the tafsir, he writes that there were only two limbs that were in function: his heart and his tongue. His heart and his tongue. And with this heart and his tongue of his, he was saying, La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin. He was remembering the Creator, that there's no wrong on the part of the Creator. If there's anything wrong, if there's any oppression, if there's any error, if there's any mistake, it's on my behalf. And he continued to remember Allah, and he gave this perception, he gave this message, and this is what Allah has recorded in the Quran, that even though he lost everything, he did not want to lose the connection with the Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why he constantly remembered Allah, even in that state of difficulty. And this is why we say, if you want to see patience, study the patience of Ayyub alayhi salatu wasalam, the Prophet Ayyub alayhi salatu wasalam. Imagine a person has everything in the world, but then when they meet the Creator, when we meet our Creator, if we are told that you're a failure, if we are told that you achieved what you achieved, people talked about you, people praised you, they followed your authority, you had followers on Twitter, you had fans on Facebook, but if Allah says on that day that you're a nobody, you didn't do what I commanded, whatever you did, it was not for the sake of Allah, it was not for my sake, then really we are failures. خَسِرَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. Allah speaks about this in the Quran. There are some who fail in terms of this world, and they fail in terms of the hereafter. And we don't want to be in this boat. We don't want to be in that rank. We want to be amongst those who succeed in this world, and most importantly, succeed in the presence and the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah, he makes a mention and he says, مَنْ كَانَ لِلَّهِ كَانَ اللَّهُ لَهُ مَنْ كَانَ لِلَّهِ كَانَ اللَّهُ لَهُ. The person who devotes themselves to the Creator, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala devotes himself to that servant of his. To that servant of his. So we want to be amongst the ibad. We want to be amongst those who are the servants and the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what is the condition of a slave? Whatever the master instructs, the slaves adhere. The slaves follow through. And the more the obedience, the greater the position of that slave. I've mentioned the story of Bahlul a number of times at the occasion of Ramadan, etc. Bahlul, when he was told, you're a foolish man, people looked for occasions where they could point out his foolishness. He was working in the court of the king, Harun al-Rashid, and the ruler of the time. And one day the king, he was in a very good mood, and he came out and he said, you know what, I'm in a good mood today. Whatever your hands touch in my palace, it belongs to you. So some went and gathered jewelry, and some went and gathered furniture, and different commodities and assets that were there in the royal palace. But Bahlul came and he sat next to the king, the ruler, Harun al-Rashid, and he touched the king. So they said, didn't we tell you that you're a foolish man? The king has given us an opportunity to gather whatever we could, so that we could use this. So he said, I'm not foolish, you're foolish. That you'll take this furniture, you'll take this gold and this silver and these commodities, but there's going to be a time where it's going to deplete. It's going to go away, it's going to perish. I've put my hands on the king, so whatever I require from the king, I will make a request and tell him, you know what, this is what I need, and he'll give it to me. So fool is not me, fools are you. So we want to be connected to the Creator who relieves us of our difficulties. And this is one first benefit. The ulama, they explain that one of the benefits, one of the most important benefits of remembering Allah, of being obedient to Allah, of surrendering to Allah, is that our stress, our difficulties, they will reduce. The stress that we face in difficulties. And you know, you study people in North America, people in the Western world, this is one sickness, this is one tremendous challenge, that we're so stressed. We're in so much difficulty in terms of our well-being. We may have it all in terms of peace and tranquility. We may have it all in terms of commodities, and we have multiple choices as to what we want to eat, what we want to wear, where we want to travel to, what kind of mode of transportation. And we have access to all this information technology. However, when it comes to our inner peace, it's not there. And we're looking for peace in all forms of entertainment. Right? The entire world is looking at the Olympics. Billions of dollars. And what is it? It's all about entertainment to try and get that void that we feel as human beings within us to get that void out so that we can be satisfied to some degree. And we watch these games and we watch these competitions, and I'm not giving no fatwa that you cannot watch Olympics. Right? No, that's not a problem. Just make sure you're punctual with your duties to Allah and the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. Healthy competition is healthy. So, but the purpose, many of the times, is simply to satisfy the nafs, to satisfy the ego. And when we feel this temporary satisfaction, we feel good. But then, when we turn off the entertainment, when we finish watching the episode, when we're offline, then that void, that emptiness, it's still there. It's not constant. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, they tell us that the inner peace, it comes from obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It comes from remembrance of Allah. It comes with knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Creator. Following the teachings of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. The verse of the Quran echoes in our minds. It summons us. Ala bi dhikri Allahi tatma'innu al-qulub. Be aware. This is harfu tanbih. Ala is harfu tanbih. Those of us who know a little bit of Arabic. Ala refers to be aware, be cautious, open your ears, open your eyes. Ala bi dhikri Allahi tatma'innu al-qulub. It is through the remembrance. And the tafsir of this is fi ita'atillah. When we remember Allah, when we are aware of the Creator, then we will obey the Creator. But if we don't have the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it'll be very easy for me to disobey the Creator and go against His commands. So how do we reinforce? We all have the spark. And this is why we are here. We are gathered here to obey Allah. Allah commands us in Surah Al-Jum'ah, فَاسْعَوْا إِلَىٰ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. On the day of Jum'ah, go and hear the remembrance of Allah. So we are all here. This proves that we have love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we should be proud about this in a positive way, that we have this connection. There are so many who don't bother about these store of commands. But we are here, so we need to be positive about this. We all have the spark. We all have the ability and the potential. We just need to reinforce it, remind ourselves again and again. And we see this many times, how many reminders come, you know, in our inboxes. That, you know what, this bill is due. You know what, this is what you have to do. Our calendars, our schedules, they ask us, you want a reminder? How often? You know, do you want it 10 minutes before the meeting? Do you want it half an hour before the meeting? The option is yours. Or you don't want a reminder at all. And many times we need the reminder. So we schedule ourselves. So why is it that we have no place in our schedules for remembering Allah, for reinforcing our faith, for following the teachings of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him? So the first action item that we need to undertake to reinforce the remembrance of Allah and the obedience of Allah is to realize that we need Allah. Is we need to realize that Allah should be on the priority list. We should take it as important. And if we realize, imagine a person has a really venomous form of cancer. It's so detrimental that according to the medical professionals, if they diagnose this individual and they come to a conclusion and they inform this individual, it's so venomous that it's probably that death is very near for you according to our research and our diagnosis. But this individual doesn't even realize the dangers of that sickness. So if this person is not aware, doesn't have the realization, how are they going to take the next step of seeking treatment? of getting medication, of consulting professionals in the field. So the same idea, if we go about our days, if we go about our weeks and our months, and we don't realize and we don't have the awareness of Allah in our lives, then we won't take the next step of making efforts to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to remember Allah. So this is the very first step that we need to have realization. Again, coming back to the Olympics, the athletes, the countries that are being represented at the Olympics, their goal is on the medal. So they're ready to spend billions of dollars so that their countries can bring back a medal. So the goal is there, and every effort is being made by the athlete himself. Our Prime Minister met with some of the athletes. You know, try to get an appointment with Prime Minister Harper, especially now with an organization, a Muslim organization, advocacy organization, filing a complaint against the Prime Minister in terms of his travels with potential terrorist groups from the Jewish community. And again, we don't brush every individual of the Jewish community with the same brush. There are good people, minhum ummatum muqtasida. Allah says there are great people from amongst the Jewish community, from every community. There are bad apples everywhere, but majority of the people are good. So try to get an appointment with the Prime Minister. But the Prime Minister is meeting with athletes to raise their spirits. The objective is we raise their spirits. We give them whatever it takes. We give them the training. We spend billions of dollars. They've been training for years for these few days of the Olympics. The goal is on the medal. And whatever it takes to attain that goal is being undertaken from the highest levels of government to the average individual. They're wearing Olympic gear. You know, we have students in the school here also with the spirit of the Olympics wearing some Olympic gear. So this is all connected to that goal of bringing back the medal. So if we have a realization, if we have the goal that Allah is the goal to please the Creator, then we will make the necessary effort. Sometimes, you know, we say, I don't have time to pray. Especially with the, you know, days being short. Asr and Maghrib, it's so difficult. So if a person has a goal in mind, they'll find the time to pray. If a person has the goal in mind that I have to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they'll undertake sacrifices. They'll undertake some struggle because the goal is more important than the temporary discomfort. Right? We have two funerals from our own community today. One is taking place in Brampton. One is taking place right here in our masjid. These were people who are amongst the founders and the volunteers of our community, sacrificing. Their life has come to an end. Their life has come to an end. Their sacrifices, their struggle for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help the communities, to establish the masjid, to raise the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this part of the land where it's difficult in many cases to practice. Yet, they had the goal in mind and they're leaving a legacy. They're leaving a legacy and they continue on their path and their journey to the ultimate goal, and that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the first step is we need to have the realization. Number two is we need to connect with anything that connects with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to love whatever increases the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to link with anything that links up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, is being referred to in the Holy Quran with the same terminology that is generally spoken about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ita'ah, obedience. So Allah says, أَطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولِ. Obey Allah, obey the Prophet. Be obedient to the Creator, be obedient to the Prophet. In reality, we are only to be obedient to Allah, the Creator. Yet Allah is using the same terminology He uses for Himself, for His Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings upon him. The reason being is by obeying Allah, we are actually obeying the Prophet, we are actually obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There were two individuals at the time of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. Both were beggars. They came in the presence of the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. And they were seeking some material. The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, went out of his way to make some arrangements. All he could find was a single date, a khajur, a single date. And he passed it on to one of the beggars. And the beggar looked at the date and he said, "What am I going to do with this?" And he left. Another beggar came and he took the date and he said, "Tamratum mir Rasulillah. Tamratum mir Rasulillah. This is a date from the Messenger of Allah." He valued that little that came from the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him. In reality, it's not coming from the Prophet, it's coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when someone looked at his excitement and someone saw his passion for that one small date, they asked him, "You know, what value does this have? It's only a date. You probably won't even fill yourself with that one date, with that one khajur." So he responded by saying, "This may be qaleel, this may be less, but qaleelum min Rasulillah kathir. A little from the Prophet is actually a lot." Right? So whatever connects us with Allah, and what are the things that connect us with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Our prayer, 5 times daily salah, analyze yourselves. I need to look into myself. How punctual am I? Right? The ulama, they're asked, how can we connect with Allah? How can we reinforce our connection with Allah? They say with the fara'id. Number one, with the fara'id. Anything that is mandatory. So if we've been delaying hajj for so many years, it's a fard. We have the ability. Yet we're delaying. We're waiting for this to happen or this to happen. Someone to get married in our family. Our businesses to increase their bottom line. We're waiting for all these things. Yet the fard is knocking on our door and we're delaying. So whatever little we can do, don't delay. Do it now because we don't know. The examples are right in front of us. People are passing away one after another. And we don't know when our turn will come. So we need to connect with anything that connects with Allah. A companion named Rabi' ibn Ka'b al-Aslami radiyallahu anhu, he would help the Messenger, peace and blessings upon him. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would always try and pay back anyone who assisted him in material as well as in supplication and dua. So he asked Rabi'a once that, you know, make a request and I'll make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This was a companion after all. He said, "As'aluka murafaqataka fil jannah." He said, "I have one request. You're asking me to make a request, O Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My request is, I want to be with you in paradise. I want to be with you in paradise." Now the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him's paradise is probably Jannatul Firdaus, the highest of all. Most definitely. And Rabi'a, being an average, as they say, Zayd, Amr, and Bakr, or the English version of this is Tom, Dick, and Harry. So average individual, average companion. He's saying, "I want to be with you in paradise." So what did the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, he say? He said, "Awa ghayra dhalik." He said, "Is there anything else that you can ask me to request? Because you've asked for something that is magnanimous, that is huge. Being with me in paradise is no ordinary issue. It's no ordinary merit." So he said, "Huwa dhak." He said, "This is what I asked. You asked me to make a request. I'm making a request." So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, "Fine, I'm going to make dua. And Allah will accept my dua on your behalf. But it won't be easy for you. I ask you," and this is my message here, "to link up with something that links with Allah." He said, "Alayka bi kathrati sujood." He said, "Don't just suffice with the minimum bare. Alayka bi kathrati sujood. Be punctual in constant, consistent prostration." Meaning perform additional prayers. Don't just suffice with the fard. As one of my colleagues said, if a person is very punctual with their tahajjud, with their qiyam, with their nightly prayer, you think they're going to abandon the 5 fard? They're punctual with the optional, so for sure they will not be deficient when it comes to the mandatory. So there has to be something beyond the minimum basic. There has to be something beyond just the Friday prayer, or just the weekly halaqa. There has to be something more than that. And these things that link us up with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it reinforces our relationship and our remembrance, our obedience with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And finally, as time is not on my side, what we need to constantly do is supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to make a lot of dua. We need to make a lot of dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Oh Allah, I want to be an obedient slave of yours. Oh Allah, facilitate it for me. It's difficult for me. It's challenging. I have so many responsibilities. I have so many challenges. Oh Allah, you facilitate it for me. Tawfiq is from you. Divine ability is from you. Oh Allah, you facilitate it for me. Let me conclude with a narration. Ummu Anas radiyallahu ta'ala anha, the mother of Anas radiyallahu, no ordinary woman. She came to the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, and asked a profound question. That what is the link that can link me up very quickly to the Creator? Very quickly to the Creator. And the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, responded by saying, أَكْثِرِي مِن ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Be constant, be consistent, be excessive. أَكْثِرِي. Be excessive in the remembrance of Allah, in the obedience of Allah. فَإِنَّكِ لَا تَأْتِينَ اللَّهَ بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبَّ إِلَيْهِ مِن كَثْرَةِ ذِكْرِ. There is nothing that is more beloved to Allah, that can take you close to Allah, than the remembrance and obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is what we want to reinforce. This is what we want to remind ourselves about. Last year when I was in Umrah, there was a young brother with me, and he confessed to me. He said, I'm in Saudi Arabia, I'm in front of the Kaaba, but I'm telling you, I feel no spirituality. I feel no spirituality here. He said, how do I change this? How do I change this? I said, you know, I asked him, you know, let's take you in confidence. Let me ask you a few things. And I asked him a few things. And he literally said, I do nothing for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm not punctual with my prayers. I'm not, you know, I don't bother about fasting in the month of Ramadan. I don't bother about these kind of things. And I said, look, you know what? If we don't have something that is going to increase that flame, then this is what will actually happen. We'll come to Saudi Arabia, we'll come to Makkah, but we'll be more busy with shopping. We'll be more busy about whether the air condition is working in our 5-star hotel room, and the bus being delayed. We'll be more concerned about that than our spirituality in making sujood before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the Kaaba, and having our du'as being accepted. So I asked him to do one thing. You know what? Just take the Quran. Take the Quran, recite one or two verses, look at the translation. If you have any questions, ask me, and see if your spirituality is increasing. So he promised to do it. Within 3-4 days, he came back to me and he said, I feel now God is speaking to me. I feel Allah is speaking to me. I said, you did it in 3 days. Imagine if you did this every single day of the year. Just read 2 verses every day with its translation, and you start your day like that, and you're punctual with your prayers. Imagine what spirituality you'll feel when you are here at the Kaaba. And he made a promise that he'll do it. So these are examples that we may have left Allah, but it's not too late. We can turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is there, His doors are open. We need to constantly reinforce our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, despite the challenges, despite the difficulties. And the examples are there, right? We need Allah the way the fish need Allah. We need to have the goal just the way the athlete has the goal. The countries have the goal that we're going to bring back the medal. Our goal is we're going to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us in our lives. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reinforce our relationship with Him. May Allah allow us to constantly remember Him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to be obedient to Him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to find time in our daily schedules to dedicate ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And may Allah give us the best in this life as well as in the hereafter. Wa akhiru da'wana. Alhamdulillah.